and sign up for one. They're $15 each. As you can tell, our shirts are still out. We are trying to raise funds for the picnic and playground area. They are a minimum of $20 each, but if you want to give more, please do so. There are many sizes and many colors and many styles, so come check them out. For this next announcement, you have to be really quiet because we don't want Steve to hear it. I don't think he knows about it yet. We're going to be having a special reception after the PM service celebrating his 20th year here at Calvary. Yeah, he's old.
He's watching me.
So you come and celebrate with us as we celebrate him being here at Calvary for so long. This next Saturday on April the 1st at 8 o'clock a.m., the men are having another men's breakfast. No fooling you here. This is real. They're going to be having tofu sausage and quiche. I'm serious. Calvary Baptist directories are online and ready to go look at. There's a website that you need to go to and a code that you need to enter in order to access the right directory. The link should be in your bulletin, so make sure and grab one of those and go check it out. Stay in touch with Calvary's family. That's all the announcements we have this morning, so let's enjoy some worship.
Awesome. Well, thank you guys so much for the treasure sale. I don't know if y'all all received that email, but the students made about $4,600 on that. And so praise the Lord for that, and thank you guys for your prayers. Yes, praise the Lord. But one thing we like to do here at Calvary is start us off in prayer. I'm going to ask if Jonathan would play some music for this. But if you would just lift up this service, maybe ask God to open up your heart this morning, and that James, that you would pray for James, that James Shelton is going to bring our message this morning, and that you would just give, that God would give him the words to say this morning. If you want to come to the altar, if you want to grab a hand, you can do that. But you pray this morning as we start this worship off.
Father, I just come to you, just lifting up Jonathan and the youth band to you, Father. I just ask that the music just do nothing but just honor and glorify you. And Father, I just want to lift my brother James up to you, Father, and ask that you'll just hide him behind the cross and just lay on his heart what you would have him to say. And Father, I just lift our nation up to you and ask that you'll just keep your hand upon our nation and just continue to bless our nation. Father, just be with our president and our leaders, Father. Just give them the wisdom and knowledge that they need to make all the right decisions. And Father, I just ask that you'll just be with our first responders, Father, and our military. Father, just keep them safe and that no harm will come to them. And Father, if there's one here that needs to make a decision, whatever that decision is, Father, I ask that they make it before it's too late. Go with us now, Father, through the rest of this day. Forgive us of our sins. I ask these and all other blessings for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen. Children, why don't you come on down for the children's moment?
Morning. I have a little bit more hair than Steve. But he asked me to do the children's moment this morning. So what better way to include kids than to bring food, which we are not going to be eating this morning, not in the service. We'll wait till after. So to start with, who knows how to make blueberry muffins? Come on. You're supposed to be impressing these adults in here. None? Okay. Well, I have a recipe without measurements because that's how I roll. So to start with, you have to get a bowl. You need to put in flour, sugar, baking powder, salt, egg, vanilla extract, milk, and blueberry. But that's not all you need. You also need to have mixing bowls so that you can mix everything up. You need to have measuring cups and spoons. You also need to have, for those of us who are a little bit more lazy, a KitchenAid mixer. Some people like a little whisk. Have you ever just been in the kitchen when they're making and you think, oh my goodness, all of those things are going into that bowl. How do they do it? Well, lots of years of experience and lots of mess ups. So with everything that goes into that, what I wanted to talk about today is that those muffins, these little muffins right here, are one muffin, but so many different pieces and parts go into it. So with all of these ingredients, it's kind of similar to the church. The church is one unit, but there are all so many different pieces and parts and ages and talents that go into making the church whole. Does that make sense? So if you go into 1 Corinthians, there's this guy who wrote a letter to all of the different churches. Corinthians is one of those churches. What he said in chapter 12, verse 18. So it's actually a huge chapter, but I'm not going to read everything. Just going to start with this part, okay? It says, verse 18 says, but our bodies have many parts, and God has put each part just where he wants it. How strange a body would be if it only had one part. Yes, there are many parts, but only one body. The eye can never say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head can never say to the feet, I don't need you. So like in these muffins, it would be really bad if you didn't have sugar in it, right? Yeah, no, muffins need sugar, right? And blueberries, right? So the same way with the church is that you have people of all different ages and different talents, and you need each and every single one of those to make the church as beautiful and as great as it is so that we can praise God. All right, let's go ahead and say a prayer. Father, thank you so much for bringing us all together today, each and all of us with our own age and our own talents and our own experiences. I pray that these kids will figure out exactly what it is that you're calling them to do here and let them know that we need them here in this church. And I pray that you'll just bless the rest of this service and bless James as he's bringing the message. And please bless the youth as they're also helping us worship you today. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Diana. Such a good and true word that we are one body with many parts. And we want to thank you as part of the youth praise band that we would be able to lead you this morning. So if you want to stand, sit, do whatever it is you need to do to worship this morning as we sing I'll Fly Away.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
When the shadows
of this life have grown, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
Just a few more days.
Just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away, I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory, I'll away.
It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
When
peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll,
whatever my lot,
whatever my taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul. My sin, know the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin not in part, but the whole.
He took it to the cross, church.
His nail to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul. It is well with my soul. It is well with my soul.
And Lord, haste the day.
And Lord, haste the day when my face shall be sight. The clouds be rolled back like a
trump will sound.
The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
It is well.
It is well. It is well with my soul. What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fountain
nothing but the blood of Jesus.
This is all my hope.
This is all my hope and peace. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. This is all my righteousness. Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know. Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
As we celebrate this morning, we're going to sing hallelujah, hallelujah. It's just that simple. We're just going to sing hallelujah to him this morning. You can join us.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
But his blood can make us clean, church. And so God is good. He's so good. Let's sing that just to close off this morning.
God is so good. God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me.
Father God, I am so grateful that you are so good. And you're great. And Father, I pray that you would just help us to worship you this morning in honesty. Father, that we would come with an open heart and say, I want you to speak to me, Lord. So God, I pray that you use Jonathan as he sings a special this morning. And Father, I pray that you speak through James, that we wouldn't hear his voice, but that we would hear yours speaking through him. In your name I pray.
Something was different. The sun. God will lead the way, and soon they all will say, there he goes, a hero, a savior to the world. There he stands with scars in his hands, with love he gives. Sick, but he was called a hypocrite. Way behind the storm, his death was surely mourned. He left the curtain torn. There he goes, a hero, a savior to the world. There he stands with scars in his eyes. He gave his life so we could be free, the savior of the world, the savior of the world. He chose to take the cross, shed tears for the lost, the broken and the needy, forgiving those who are and will be. He told them, have no fear, he's not here, he's not here. There he goes, a hero, a savior to the world. There he stands, with scars in his eyes. He gave his life so we could be free, the savior of the world, the savior of the world, the savior of the world, the savior of.
So situated here. Talking about Steve having 20 years being here at Calvary, and I got to think about, I could say something like, well, I knew Steve back when he had hair, but I don't know if that was possible. Maybe I knew him back when he had more hair. Amen. But I tell you what, it's a blessing to get to come to you today and to talk to you, and enjoyed seeing the youth get up and lead the song service this morning. What a blessing that is to see kids willing to get up and to worship. Amen. You know, because that's what we need to be, to worship God, you know, and that's what it's about. And it's not just within these walls, but it's also beyond those doors. This morning, turning your Bibles to Matthew chapter 13, verses 31 through 35. We'll read the scripture here in just a moment. But we're going to talk about something I believe is essential to us as Christians, to know that no matter how small, minute we may feel, that little is much when God is in it. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, I come to you again today. Father God, I just thank you for this day. And God, what a blessing it is to get to speak to these people. But God, I realize that it's not about me. It's about you. I must decrease and you must increase. God, your spirit must speak to these people's hearts, God. It must flow out of me. And God, may we receive your word. May we apply it. First, Father, may it begin in my heart. Father, truly, no matter how small, mind you, we may feel, and vast of so many, that truly little is much when you're in it. And you can do great and mighty things if we allow you to. In Christ's name I pray. Amen. You know, in the chapter of Matthew that we're fixing to read, we often see where, and we all know that Jesus speaks oftentimes in parables. He uses parables quite a bit throughout his ministry. And even in this chapter alone, he speaks of seven parables. And all seven parables that he speaks of consist of the kingdom of heaven, all with the exception of one, he uses some form of agriculture to relate his message to the people. And we read of two occasions in this chapter where Jesus not only speaks these parables, but he goes beyond that to interpret the parables to his disciples. And oftentimes we may begin to wonder then, if these parables he had to go and interpret them, why did he speak in them? Why does Jesus speak in parables? Well, the answer is this. First, we must understand that a parable is the use of an earthly story, but yet it has heavenly truths hidden within it. It has divine spiritual truths that are essential to the life of a Christian. Stories that he tells are easy to remember because we can relate to what he speaks about, to what he's referencing here. The characters are bold. The symbolism is rich. In fact, Judaism uses many forms of parables even to this very day in their teaching. It came to a certain point in Jesus' ministry where he used many parables. He used common things that people could relate with, that they could associate with, things like salt and bread and sheep. And even here we see the use of a small little seed. Their meaning was very clear to those who were eagerly hungering and thirsting for what he was teaching. Parables oftentimes required more of an explanation because people didn't grasp exactly what all Jesus was talking about. Like, for instance, when Jesus talked about sowing of the seed amongst the different types of souls, it flew over a lot of the people's head. It even flew over the disciples' head. So therefore, Jesus took his disciples aside and began to explain to them what that parable meant. His disciples often wondered, like we may wonder, then why did he teach in parables? And they asked him in verse 10 of that chapter, he says, why do you speak in parables? To which Jesus told him, says, to you it has been granted to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been granted. For whoever has, to more of him it shall be given, and he will have abundance. Now Jesus says, as you begin to learn these truths, as you begin to apply these truths, then God begins to open more truths to you. He said, but whoever does not have, that even what he has shall be taken away. Therefore, Jesus says, I speak to them in parables because they do not see. And even though they're hearing, they do not hear. They choose to not understand. Basically, the people were just choosing to only get what they wanted out of it. And many times we do that with God, do we not? We do that with our Christian life. We do that with the church oftentimes. We do that when we need something, when we have something that hits our life, whether it be through a death or sickness or disease or tragedy or the need of a job or whatever it is. That's when we seek God. We seek God for superficial things, but God wants to know us on a much deeper level as he desires for us to know him. And God knows us, but we have to desire that deeper things. And so Jesus spoke in these parables to them. He said, their ears are hard of hearing and their eyes have closed, lest that they should see. Lest indeed that they should understand with their hearts, and lest indeed they should hear. And in fact, if they would, Jesus said, I would heal them. But then Jesus tells his disciples, blessed are you, because your eyes, they're willing to see. Blessed are you because your ears are willing to hear. He said, truly I tell you that many prophets before time, many righteous men before time, desired to see what you get to see and to hear what you get to hear, but did not. It's a blessing, folks, that God opens up the truth of his words through his Holy Spirit to give us spiritual discernment so that we may see and know God on a much deeper personal level. Jesus used parables But he only explained it to those who were truly desiring the heart of God. Those who desired his truths and his teachings. He explained them here to his disciples. But those who only wanted what they could get out of Jesus, they were left spiritually dark. Jesus addressed the same thing when after he had fed the 5,000, he went off over by himself and then went to this land and he went over to the other side and he peered out over the valley and he seen the vast majority of people coming up to him, and it said his heart began to cry. He began to weep. Why? Because he knew what they come for. And he told them, he said, "You only came here because of the miracle I performed the other day of feeding the 5,000. You came here for the loaves and fish. In other words, you came for something physical. But I have something much greater. Something more important, that which is spiritual. If you would hunger for that." Jesus made a clear distinction here of who was willing to hear and who wasn't. Paul said the same thing in 2 Timothy. He said, there's people out there who's always learning but never able to acknowledge the truth. The disciples were truly blessed, as we are blessed, giving the ability to have spiritual discernment. Meaning we have the Holy Spirit who speaks to us, who guides us, as Jesus says, into all truths. But Jesus also understood that some of these truths are not always pleasant to the ear. Some of these truths require a change, a transformation within our hearts. Most of the time, we like to hear the good things. It's kind of like we want to take the good things out of the Bible. Thomas Jefferson did this. He didn't like all the negative things in the Bible, so he began to rip out all the stuff he didn't like, and he formed himself a Bible that he thought was just pleasing to him. And we often do that, do we not? But it's hard when we hear the truth that's literally going to rock our world, change our lives, change those who are around us. Oftentimes, we don't want that part. But Jesus looks for people who desires such things. So why did he speak in parables? Well, the answer is very simple. He wanted those who truly hunger and thirst after God's word to be filled and to be fed. Those who would go mining after it as a person searching for that one little ounce of gold. Those who would seek for the deeper meanings that's within God's word. Something so that their spiritual walk can become more than what it is now. They can grow and they can abound. And Jesus did just that. I'm continually amazed how he uses simple things such as seeds and yeast, but yet he attaches great truths to it if we're willing just to open our hearts and our minds to what he's telling us today. Because truly we find, and even in those little things, there's great truths and great meaning, and there's great application when God is in it. Look at our text this morning. Verse 31 said, "He presented another parable to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like that unto a mustard seed, which a man took it and he sowed it in his field, and that is much smaller than all other seeds. But when it is full grown, it is larger than the garden plants and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and they nest upon its branches." Then he spoke to them another parable. He said, "The kingdom of heaven is likened to leaven, which a woman took and it hid into 3 pecks of flour until it was all leavened." All these things Jesus spoke to the crowds in parables, and he did not speak to them without a parable, so that it would be fulfilled what the prophet said, "I will open my mouth in parables, and I will utter things that were hidden since the foundation of the world." So we look at things today that are small. Things like the size of a mustard seed. Things like a little bit of yeast. The size of a mustard seed can produce something great and mighty. The little bit of yeast add to some flour and some dough can do something great and mighty. It can cause the dough to double in its size. So truly little is much when God is in it. Most of you may be acquainted with that phrase because you're acquainted with the song that's associated with that phrase. You might have even sung it at this church. You've sung it down the years, little as much when God is in it. Labor not for wealth or fame. There's a crown and you can win it if you'll go in Jesus' name. A lady who wrote that song was the lady, she wrote it in 1924. Her name was Kitty Suffield. And it remained quite an unknown song until the Gaither Vocal Band put it out upon the airwaves, and it became to be known as a song that was sung in many churches. Sung as many hymnals. One of the verses says, does the place you're called to labor seem so small and little known? It is great if God is in it, because he'll not forget his own. Amen. So truly, little is much when God is in. Now let's go a little bit behind the music. The church where she attended, she was a pianist at that church in Ottawa, Canada. There at that church, the pastor that pastored that church, he had a son. The son was very shy and very timid and very inward. You know, he's an introvert. He didn't really like getting up before people. He felt uncomfortable, you know, doing something like this or getting up singing a special as what we had today. He felt shy. Now, God had blessed him with a voice. And Kitty seen this voice and seen this talent that this man had and knew that if he would surrender himself to God and surrender that talent to God, that God could use him mightily. But he was so timid and shy and he was afraid to do that. So she prayed for him and she encouraged him as much as she could. And she really put faith into action when she truly believed that little is much when God is in it. And he was indeed greatly, when he surrendered that talent over to the Lord, was greatly and mightily used. Many of you know him, who died last year, but many of you know him through the Billy Graham Crusades as George Beverly Shea. This woman truly believed that little is much when God is in it. We're going to look at that today and truly see how God can use us. Sometimes we feel so small and minute amongst a church of so many. Sometimes we feel so small and minute against a neighborhood, a community of so many, and think, can we truly make a difference? And I'm here today to tell you we can. So let's look at the mustard seed. Jesus here is using this mustard seed, and he begins to use it. Most of us, we're acquainted with the mustard seed and the size of it, but we're acquainted with it where Jesus says, if you have the faith in the size of a mustard seed, you can say to this mountain, be moved, and it will be moved, because nothing will be impossible for you. But Jesus is not talking about faith here. What may be shocking is that Jesus says, look how small this mustard seed is. And he references it to the kingdom of God being just likened unto that size of that mustard seed. Now that may kind of be mind-blowing for us. We may kind of be shocked to know that the kingdom of God is that size, that small. But Jesus just doesn't stop and leave it there. But he says, once it's planted, it grows into something enormous. It not only doubles or triples, it grows into a tree that can be over 8 feet tall. A tree that can grow big branches and provide nesting and shelter for the birds. A tiny seed, yes it is. But it's a tiny seed with great potential. The kingdom of God is likened to that. God takes these seeds, he takes this and he plants it within the hearts of individuals. He plants it in people before us. He plants it in us. What? So that he can grow the kingdom of God. Paul uses the same analogy when he speaks of himself and Apollos, where he says, I planted and Apollos watered. But he said, what? It's God who gave the increase. In other words, my planting and his watering seem about the same. We're sharing the gospel of Christ out there to those who are lost. We're being the hands and feet of Christ, reaching out to our community. You don't know if you're planting a seed. You don't know you may be watering a seed that's already been planted by somebody else. But it's God who births it. It's God who grows it. God is faithful to grow his kingdom. Yes, his kingdom may have started out small, but it has grown, has it not? Jesus even told his disciples, there's going to be places that you're going to go and reap a harvest on that you neither toiled nor labored upon. Isn't that amazing? That yes, we don't know if we're planting or watering, but there's also fields we're going to go to that we didn't toil or labor on, but yet we get to enjoy the harvest if we're willing just to go. If we're willing just to go and be what God wants us to be, to go out and plant seeds and water seeds. God is faithful to his word. God will give increase. God will grow his kingdom. It said that a mustard seed is tiny, is just a little bit larger than a grain of sand. Now, the past couple of days, we know about this, the grain of sand, do we not? With the wind that's blown and stuff. But can you imagine that? Something that small can do something great and mighty. You go out and you get a grain of sand and you go out and you plant it and you water it, nothing's going to happen. because there's no life in the grain of sand. But that mustard seed, even as small as it is, if you plant it and water it, it will grow. It will grow into a big, humongous plant that will later turn into an 8-foot tree. The kingdom of God, Jesus says, it's like this mustard seed, meaning it has something within it that's alive and active. In other words, the kingdom of God is living, folks. It's not dead. It's alive. Oh, the way this world is going right now may make some of us begin to question and wonder, is it still alive? But let me tell you, it is still growing. It is still alive and active. We see it in numerical growth. And by this, I'm not talking about numbers that's added to the church roll. I'm not talking about people who join the church. I'm talking about people who receive the word of God, who see the gospel, and accept Jesus Christ as their Savior. We see it through testimonies of missionaries, whether it be through the Lottie Moon Christmas offering or the Annie Armstrong Easter offering. We see it through missionaries who's out there reaching out to people in faraway lands. We hear of professions of faith being made. We see it and hear of churches that are being planted and growing, that churches that are probably being planted on areas that they see abundance of harvest taking place because somebody took the time to plant. Somebody took the time to water. Somebody took the time to be a laborer. So let's not view ourselves as grains of sand, but let's view ourselves as a mustard seed. Even though small we may be, even though very little we feel in comparison to other people, but yet great and mighty we are because of what resides within us. It's alive and it's active. And if we allow it, it will grow and it will flourish. Not only do we see numerical growth as far as talking about the professions of salvation, but we also see spiritual growth. And that's the main thing we should look for, spiritual growth. When you look at a church, you should look and see, you have churches that grow in number, but it doesn't mean that they're growing spiritually. You should look at the spiritual health of a church. Is it growing spiritually? Well, let me tell you something, church. The only way that the church itself can grow spiritually is that we as individuals have to desire spiritual growth. We should desire to want to grow. We must look for spiritual growth. We must desire. How do we know if we're growing or not? Well, watch your heart. What's in your heart? What's your passion? Is it truly for the things of Christ? Because if you're growing as a Christian, and as you begin to grow and mature in your faith, then your heart desires after that which is pleasing to God. It grows. And it grows. But not only does it grow in a deeper relationship with Him, and deeper fellowship with Him, but it also grows in your service to Him. What's the sign of a growing, spiritual growing Christian? It's a person whose heart thirsts and hungers after God, who hungers and thirsts after righteousness. It's one who looks upon daily feeding upon God's Word as essential and needful for their spiritual health. It's one who takes the love of Christ and not only wants to just experience it himself, but yet wants to share it with others, to go beyond these doors and share the love of Christ. It's much like when you see a newborn. And many of you here today, you know what it is to have a newborn, have experienced a newborn. It takes a lot of care and nurturing after that, does it not? They're not born and you immediately send them off and say, okay, now it's time for you to take care of yourself. No, it takes a lot of nurturing. It's over a time process. The same thing it is for us. We got a desire to want to grow, but yet we look to other people that come along and help mentor us. It's essential that you who are mature believers help those who are immature. Those who are younger, and I'm not talking about necessarily young in age. I'm talking about even people who are just young in their faith. To mentor them. Often we're guilty, are we not? Somebody gets saved and they give their heart to the Lord and we give them a Bible and we hug them and we tell them, read the Bible, talk to God, and we send them off and that's it. Would you do that to your newborn child? No. you look after, you nurture, you feed, you take care of. That's what we're called to do. Basically, I'm telling you, we're called all to be teachers and instructors. Basically, what Jesus said, we're called to be disciple makers, are we not? Disciple makers. Jesus told his disciples to go out and make disciples and teach them all that I observe you do. And then what? Then they go out and they do the same thing. We are to become teachers, disciple makers. Spiritual maturity has nothing to do with age. It has to do with your hunger and your passion and your desire for the things of God. But sadly, we're lacking, are we not? The writer of Hebrews, he had the same problem during his time. He said, here we are, having to reteach you the simple principles of God, having to refeed you the milk when you should be on the meat by now. You ought to be teachers by now. So should we. We need to allow that mustard seed to bloom within us, to grow within us, and great and mighty things we can do for the Lord. But Jesus also talks about yeast. So we talked about Jesus being in us through the mustard seed. We talked about Jesus' power now residing within us. And that's what the yeast represents. It represents God's power. And let me tell you something, church. God can change you. And he can do a mighty work in you and through you if you allow him to. Yeast has a mighty impact upon the dough that it's mixed in with. It impacts many and different many areas, like yeast impacts us. God's power impacts us in three different areas: salvation, transformation, and permeation. It affects us in the area that Christ is in us, yes. He lives within us, but not just in a certain little part of our heart, not just when we gather here on Sunday morning, but he lives in every aspect of our life. A little bit of yeast affects the whole lump of dough. So can the kingdom of God affect us. It affects every part of our life. Let me tell you, you cannot say you have an encounter with God and remain the same as you are. It affects you. It changes you. It doesn't happen immediately. It's a process, is it not? And that's what Jesus is working in you right now, is a process within you. Paul gives assurance to us, though, that that process will come to completion one day. He says, be confident in this very thing, that he who began a good work in you will carry it to completion till the day of Jesus Christ. God works in you. God works through you. He does so to transform you into the image of his Son. At the moment of salvation, he begins a work in you. And that work is still in progress. No matter how old you are, he's still working in you. And he's still working on you. We know it as what is called the sanctification process. In other words, it's the work of the Holy Spirit in our lives. But God's desire is not only purpose just to change us on the inside, but also that he may use us to help change others as well. He uses us as vessels to reach out to others. We are called to be the salt and light, are we not? We're also called to be the yeast. Like a mustard seed that has life in it, that is active and living, so is yeast. Alive and active. And in fact, on the Fleshman's Yeast website, it says, in yeast, there are thousands of living plant-like microorganisms. When it's activated by warm liquid and it's fed by sugar or starch, the yeast then begins to release tiny bubbles of carbon dioxide gas. It is this gas that makes the dough rise and achieve its light texture after baking. But if you don't put no yeast in the dough, it won't rise. It has no effect, does it not? So it is with us. If we don't allow God to work in us and then also through us, then it has no effect at all. But when we allow him to, it has a twofold effect. Not only does it affect us personally as we begin to grow ourselves in the Lord, and we may not see it at first, but yet it's a gradual process, but yet it begins to affect those who are around us as well. Jesus says that this woman takes this bit of yeast and she puts it in with three pecks of flour. In other words, what she's doing, she's incorporating it into all the dough. She doesn't put just a little bit over here and hope that the rest of the dough will rise up and fall suit. But no, she mixes it all in. So does God. God mixes it all in. You can't separate your life and say, okay, this is my Christian walk here, and this is my, well, secular walk out there with the world. You can't do that. You can't say, well, this is my part of spiritual life over here, but this is my business life. You know, I kind of got to do what I got to do over there. It's different over here. No, you can't separate it. You can't say Jesus affects my spiritual life but not my family life. No. Jesus affects everything and anything within you, working to change you. And that brings about the transformation process. See, the kingdom of God isn't just about outward appearance, but it's about an inward change that slowly transforms you into the image of His Son. It's a continual change of attitude. You know, Jesus criticized the Pharisees for being so outwardly, to be so concerned with their outward appearance, giving themselves off to look like they're holy, to look like they're spiritually clean, but yet not worried about what's on the inside. He said, you're so worried about cleaning the outside of the cup that the cup that you may touch may also make you spiritually unclean, that you forget about the inside of the cup. The inside is dirty, so will not that make you also unclean as well? Jesus said, if you clean the inside of the cup, then the outside will soon follow, will it not? Same thing with the kingdom of God. It begins to work within us. And that change begins to work without us, on the outside of us. Outward results in outward conformity. Many times we seek outward conformity first before desiring a true inward change first, do we not? And when we do that, we just become just like the Pharisees. We become just religious people. We must realize that what God is doing in you, you may not see. You may not know right at first. Just like when you add a little yeast to the dough, you cannot see it working, but you can see the results of the work as the dough begins to rise. So it is with you. You may think, well, I'm not that much of a mature Christian. I'm not that great of a Christian. I'm not that great in my walk. I'm not, especially compared to so-and-so, so-and-so over here. You know, but yet God is doing a work in you. And though you may not see it, one day, if God so chooses, He may open your eyes to see the greatness He's performing in your life. Oftentimes, though, when you ask somebody about their faith and their Christian walk, most of the time they start giving you a bunch of things that they do and they don't. Well, I attend church, I tithe, I'm an usher, I do this and I do that. And they give you deals that they don't do. But the Bible says it's not about those things. It's like what Paul writes in Romans 14, 17, said, for the kingdom of God is not about a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, of peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. The kingdom of God is not about what you eat or drink. It's not about what you do and don't do. It's about the transformation that takes place within your life that produces righteousness. Because we know that our righteousness, as the Bible says, is nothing but filthy rags before the Lord. So we must have Christ's righteousness within us. And it's about the peace that resides within our hearts, peace that passes all understanding. And it's about joy. Joy that can come in the midst of sorrow. Joy that comes in the midst of pain. It's not about being happy all the time. Being happy requires happenings in your life. But joy comes in the midst of all things in your life. You can find joy. When Jesus saved you, when Jesus saved me, He instilled within me His righteousness. And He gives me peace. And He gives me joy. And then He begins to take that and begins to knead it within my heart. He begins to shape my life. He's changing me. His desire is to change you. So that what? So you can have the permeation I talked about. Meaning that you can be the catalyst used by God to help change those who are around you. To make a difference in our culture. To make a difference in our communities. Permeation means to spread or flow throughout. When yeast comes in contact with bread dough, it serves as a catalyst. In other words, it changes, it does a chemical reaction within the dough. We call it fermentation. It creates enzymes that change the starch molecules that's in the flour into sugar, which then turns and creates carbon dioxide and alcohol. Now, you don't have to worry about, do you go eat a loaf of bread? You're not going to get drunk because the heat burns all the alcohol off. But yet, it grows and produces within you. That's the same picture Jesus is trying to reference here of what the power of God can do in the life of an individual, of one who will willing surrender himself to them. When yeast is introduced into bread dough, it changes it. It also helps influence those around it. We get to partake and enjoy the bread, do we not? The same thing when we allow the power of God to work in us and change us, it begins to affect those around us. But let me tell you, if you keep the yeast in the jar, it does nothing, and it can do nothing. Same thing as we've been called to be salt. You keep salt in the salt jar, it's not going to affect nothing, right? Or if you just continue to mix yeast with yeast, if you continue to mix salt with salt, it can't make the salt any saltier. But yet salt must come in contact with that which is not salt in order to make an effect. So must we. We can't be content with just saying, well, I've got my pass to heaven. I know I'm saved. I know I'm going to go to heaven. But yet, we've got to be willing to step out of our comfort zones. We've got to be willing to go out and make a difference. Jesus said, as my Father has sent me, so I send you. You may feel small and minute here today. You may feel like, well, I can't really make a difference in the life of anybody. I can't make the difference. You know, the church has got plenty of other people that can do that job. But yet God has a specific calling upon your life. He's telling you that within you is just like a mustard seed. It may appear to be very small, but yet it's live and active. And it can grow into something big and beautiful. And it can provide shelter to those around you. It can be like the yeast into dough, and it can grow and double in size. And if we would just be willing to allow God at times to knead our hearts and knead our lives, and that's not always pleasant. Sometimes it takes a little bit of heat to activate the yeast, does it not? Sometimes it takes that in ourselves too. But yet a mighty thing God can do through us if we're willing to surrender ourselves over to Him. God took Gideon's army of 32,000 and dwindled down to 300 to defeat an army of 100,000. God took 5 stones, you know, that David gathered up, and David threw only 1 stone to kill a giant, and it changed the history of Israel forever. More importantly, God took a little boy's lunch. Jesus took that little boy's lunch of only five loaves and 2 fish that he willingly gave to Jesus, and Jesus fed over 5,000 people that day. Little is much when God is in it. No matter how little you feel, what are you allowing God to do in your life? As Jonathan comes up to lead in hymn invitation, what are you allowing God to do in your life today? No matter how little you may seem, indeed, it can be much if God is in it. As we stand.
Seas. You walk with me through fire and heal all my disease. I trust in you. I trust in you. And I believe I believe that you are all I need. And I believe that you're my portion. And I believe you're more than enough for me. Jesus, you're all I need.
Father, Lord, it's so grateful to be in your house again, Father, to hear an amazing message, Lord. And Father, we just ask, Lord, as we move throughout this day and after we leave this place, Lord, that we allow this this message to grow in our hearts, Father, that you can grow in us and that this church can abound for you, Lord, that you might get all the glory. And Father, we ask now that you would bless this offering, that you would bless the gift and the giver. And Father, just continue to bless this church. We lift our pastor up to you as he's going through a tough time right now as well, Lord. And we just pray for a quick and speedy healing. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Thank you, James, so much for that message. I pray that we will take that with us as we leave this morning. Why don't you stand and grab a hand as we sing. We believe in the Father. We believe in the Son.
We believe in the Father. We believe in the Son. We believe in the Spirit. We believe they are one.
In the virgin birth.
We believe in the virgin birth. We believe in the empty tomb. We believe that you conquered death. We believe that you're coming soon.
We'll see you all in Sunday school.